Welcome to the C-Suite series presented by Channel Check and Noble Capital Markets. Noble's an SEC registered, FINRA licensed broker dealer and the source of the equity research available on Channel Check. Today's interview features Bowlero Corporation, NYSE ticker symbol BOWL. Noble Senior Research Analyst Michael Kopinski interviews Bowlero President and CFO Brett Parker. Visit channelcheck.com or click the link in the description to access equity research, news, and advanced market data on Bowlero, all at no cost. And now, here's Michael and Brett.
So with that, Brett, to start, could you just walk us through the history of the company through today and what led to the decision for you to go public?
Sure. Thanks, Mike. Thanks for having me. You know, I think it's important to actually start exactly here, which is we just celebrated our 25th anniversary as a company this past month, and we've been an EBITDA generating, positive cash flow generating, steady growing business for that entirety of that 25-year period. And you know, that alone, I think, sets us apart from a lot of the noise, certainly among the de-SPAC stocks, but really also just more broadly among stocks, companies as they're coming to market. So you know, that was phase one of what I'll call four phases of the history of the business, was the invention of the upscale bowling segment. And that came when Tom Shannon bought Bowlmore Union Square on 13th and University Place down in Greenwich Village, and transformed it from what everyone imagined a rundown bowling center to be into a New York nightlife, you know, very much sort of mainstream, affluent attracting, corporate attracting business. I joined in 2001, and the idea at that point was, okay, we fleshed this out, it works in New York, let's see if we can start to add units here. And we went down and we built in Bethesda, Maryland with great success, went down to Miami, Florida, we went out to California and did a couple of sites. And that was really, you know, more than a decade of growing and developing the Bowlmore brand as phase two of the company's history. And then in 2013, late 2012 initially, we had the opportunity to scale. And scale is phase three. So that's when we acquired AMF. So we went from six locations to 272 locations overnight, which was, as you would imagine, a pretty abrupt transformation for us. It was an abrupt transformation for that business as well. It was a hardcore turnaround, and we, you know, grabbed it by the neck, and we took $35 million worth of cost out in the first year. We managed revenue down somewhat and grew EBITDA by double digits right out of the gates, and really put to work all of the acumen that we had developed in managing that smaller chain. Less than a year later, we acquired Brunswick's 85 bowling centers. And by that point, we had achieved, you know, really significant scale and began to focus on optimization and unit growth, which is phase four and the current phase that we're in. And, you know, that maturation process has led us to have several capital partners over the years. We've had a lot of good experiences, but, you know, we've developed now to a point where the scope of the business, both currently and its prospects, are such that the public markets just make sense as far as the place for us to be. Where we can get access to capital at the right costs and at the right magnitude and with the right speed to allow us to continue to be agile and, you know, execute our strategy of growing the business on an organic basis, on an inorganic small transaction basis, and on an inorganic large M&A basis. So we just feel like it really sets us up to have the best future in doing it that way.
Gotcha. And it's certainly not the mom and pop bowling centers when I grew up, but this is really exciting places to be. Can you talk a little bit about the competition and the current market share that you have?
Yeah, so interesting. We're seven times larger, give or take, than the next largest player. So far and away the biggest, but at the same time, only about 8% of the market. So there are 3,500 independent bowling centers. So what that means is that we are in a position to continue to grow the unit count substantially by acquiring these one and two, three type ownership structures. And, you know, it's a bit of a grind, but that's really to our advantage, because being the only scaled player, we're really the only ones that can buy these things up and manage them in a professional manner. So we're large, we are the largest by far, but there remains a really fertile opportunity for us to go out and continue to grow by rolling up those independent units.
And Brett, you know that it's interesting because you have multiple revenue streams here. And I know from doing my research that the company has historically grown better than other experiential type companies. But can you talk a little bit about your avenues for growth and any changes that you see now that you are a public company, that how those revenue growth avenues might have changed?
Sure. So, I mean, our revenue growth vectors were and will be at least threefold, which we call the ABCs: acquire, build, and convert. So acquiring is going out and buying either individual centers or chains of centers. Building is doing new build bowling centers. We almost never build a building, but, you know, going in, it's usually second gen type, you know, reuse in a shopping center, that sort of thing. And then conversion is taking our existing traditional bowling centers, the AMF branded ones, and bringing those to the upscale model of Bowlero. So we've got three ways that we can grow, and all of them produce really high returns. So in terms of differentiation versus other players in the experiential space, there have been roll-ups, and there have been people that have found success by building new. There aren't any that I'm aware of that have successfully executed both of those strategies at the same time. And we have that, along with this significant number, more than half of our existing center base, that still is ripe for conversion. So we don't have to be subject to the whims of real estate availability or M&A pipelines drying up. We just can do whatever deals are rational that are there in front of us. And it gives us the flexibility to be able to continue to grow at a rapid pace without doing anything that's incrementally risky beyond where one should go, just in pursuit of growth. In terms of the difference of being public versus being private, it really speaks to, I think, the pace, right? So like I was saying, being a public company, having access to the public markets, puts us in a position where we're able to act quickly to the extent that any scale acquisition comes along. And that's not something that a private company could do. So, you know, knowing that we can use that stock as a currency, knowing that, you know, we're a well-known issuer in the marketplace, to the extent that we wanted to do incremental issuances of debt or equity to support a transaction, these are things that we can bang out pretty easily with the profile and the level of disclosure that we're already doing. So, you know, that's a big advantage versus where we were on a private basis.
Yeah, it's certainly an exciting growth opportunity. Where are your centers today, and where do you see opportunities for expansion? Are there specific regions in the country that are more interesting than others?
Yeah, I mean, so we're currently in more than 30 states, and we have the coasts both fairly well covered and a strong presence across the South. And then we have some other sort of key markets, I would say, where we've got pretty good clusters: Chicagoland, Minneapolis, Denver, Phoenix, etc. But there's quite a lot of opportunity for us in two ways. One is some of the markets that we're already heavy in could support way more. So California, for example, you know, we've got more than 40 locations there, but we could probably do another 40. It's just such a big place with so many population centers, and we've done, you know, extremely well there. So, you know, it's a place we could go. Also places like Florida and Texas, where you're seeing really significant growth in populations and growth in affluence in populations. You know, these are places that we're pretty focused on. And then there are white spaces on the map. Despite all the places that we are, there are a lot of places that we aren't. And ironically, much of that is the Midwest, where there's quite a lot of bowling. People are very familiar with and comfortable with bowling as an entertainment option, but we're just not there. None of the chains that we bought were heavy there. So, you know, that's an area for us that we could grow pretty rapidly into if we start to put some centerpiece dots on the map and then expand some markets around those. That's an exciting opportunity for us.
And you have this really attractive return on your bowling centers, whether it's building a new center from ground up or a rebuild, remodel at a new location. What is the value add that you bring that others don't?
Well, I'll say what we bring. I won't comment on what others don't, but I think we bring a truly professionalized business model that is pretty uncommon. We are highly quantitative. We have developed an entire system called QMS, which we don't have a ton of time to get into today, but it allows us to identify areas of opportunity within the business and then manage against those opportunities. And, you know, that's a fully in-house built thing. We've got kiosk ordering at the lanes where, you know, we've brought technology to bear. You can make your reservation and prepay for your party from your phone. You know, we've done all of these things that are pretty differentiated, but a lot of it is really just the boots on the ground management and having very clear expectations and tools for people in the field to be able to optimize the performance of their businesses, whether it's labor scheduling, food and liquor cost management, and maximizing revenue. I mean, these are all things that our unit level operators have access to tons of professionalized tools. And, you know, the proof is frankly in the pudding. So, I mean, when we look at the industry, and obviously we see the financials of a lot of locations as we go through our acquisitive process, et cetera, the average bowling center in the US does about a 20% EBITDA margin. Ours is about 50. We can get 20 of the 30 points of that gap without spending any capex. That's purely bringing our scale and our operating processes to bear on these locations and operating them according to our model. And then that last piece is really leverage around growing revenue, which is around growing spending some capex. But that's fine. But being able to take it from 20 to 40 right out of the gates, and that happens fast, that's a real differentiator for us. And it's a big part of why our returns have been so high and so consistent.
And I know that you didn't want to touch on your QMS product, but those margins are really compelling. How is it that you operate these centers so much better than your peers? Is it because of the QMS software, or what are the other tools that you have to operate at such high margins?
Yeah, so we have a lot. Probably the biggest one is experience. We have a very highly experienced team that's been together a long time. And we have a strong preference inside of our culture for developing and promoting people internally versus bringing people in from the outside. And it's not because we don't like people from the outside. It's because we like to reward our winners internally. And that's our culture, is that we play to win. And it acts a lot more like a sports team than it does like a business, in that people really are focused on winning and are extremely loyal to each other and to the business and competitive with the outside world. So, you know, general managers will pick up the phone and talk to each other. You know, hey, you know, I was looking at the results, because we have a lot of data transparency internally. They can see other people, what they're doing within the QMS system, and even just on other files. Say, hey, you know, you're running a labor cost that's, you know, 5 basis points lower than mine, and I can't figure out why. You know, can you take a look at my schedule? And they'll do it, and they'll spend time helping each other. So it's really about, you know, having the cultural sort of focus and dogma all around achieving those quantitative results, winning as a team, and having people focused on digging in and doing everything that they need to do to get there.
And Brett, as you mentioned, your centers offer a superior experience to customers, and obviously the Bowlero has a terrific brand and known for quality. Are there other metrics or insights that you can share with us regarding the brand? What are the goals for the Bowlero brand, and what is your strategy for marketing from here?
Well, you know, the Bowlero brand in our view should be synonymous with upscale bowling, and that is what our focus is. Really, the hurdle that we view for that is that we want to have the best center in every market. So that means something different across markets, but that's okay. A Bowlero in a, you know, suburban or dense rural Midwestern market just doesn't need to be the same as a Bowlero in Manhattan. And that's fine. And they can be the best in their market without being the same. But that's our expectation, is that we're going to have the best center in every market. So, you know, you asked about marketing. I would say two things. You know, one, probably the most powerful marketing engine that we have, well, certainly the most powerful marketing engine that we have, is the experience that we give to the guests who come in the door. It is materially easier to win frequency and duration from your existing guests than it is to win new guests, no matter what tools you're using. So we relentlessly focus on what we call providing delightful guest experiences. We want people to leave really blown away and wanting to come back and wanting to tell their friends. So we use the standard suite of tools that folks use. We, you know, NPS is sort of a basis, and then we've developed our own thing around that we called GSL, which is more the guest satisfaction landscape. It's just a bit of a broader view of the same question, but it's really about providing those experiences. And then, you know, number two is about, from a marketing perspective, is leveraging the PBA. So, you know, we're in a unique position of owning the Professional Sports League for bowling as well. And, you know, that effectively is a massive commercial for the sport in general and for our centers in particular. So the PBA produces about 70 hours of linear first run programming every year, gets a tremendous number of re-airs, probably close to 1,000 hours in total of TV time. We shoot the majority of that in our centers. So they are literally the backdrop. And you're constantly hearing the name throughout the telecast. You know, it's coming to you from Bowlero Euless last week, the Players Championship on Saturday night on FS1. Jason Belmonte, the winningest major bowler in history, won his 14th major last Saturday night. So that was exciting for the sport. So, you know, look, we endeavor to use that as a tool to broaden the audience, like I said, for bowling as a sport, but for us in particular. And we benefit disproportionately, not only because we focus on our name, but also because we're the largest player.
Well, I know the PBA, owning the PBA is an exciting aspect of the company's growth in the future as well, especially it gets you into the gaming and potential tournaments and things like that, that I think could offer some really dynamic growth opportunities, which I hope we can talk about in the future. Is there anything else that you would like to share or think that's important to for our listeners to walk away with, Brett?
Yeah, I think the one thing that we didn't touch on that is important for people, especially if they're just getting up to speed on the business, is to understand the fundamental magic of bowling as a business, which is that about 2/3 of our revenue comes at more than a 90% variable EBITDA margin. I mean, it's close to 100%, because there's essentially zero cost to a game of bowling. So you come in, you roll that ball down the lanes, the register is ticking, but it doesn't cost us anything. So having that operating leverage, that's just massive. So you know that anything you do to drive incremental, like I mentioned earlier, duration, frequency, any of it, you can push on any of those variables. The profitability is huge because of, you know, that incremental margin that we get.
And Brett, before we leave, the stock has been disappointing, I guess, traded off of its debut highs. Do you attribute this to the weakness in the overall general market for consumer stocks? Is there something specific to account for the weakness? And what do you believe will gain investors' attention and get the stock moving in the right direction?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's a bit outside my bailiwick to prognosticate on the market. But what I would tell you is that you know, certainly this, it feels as if we're caught in sort of a two-part downdraft right now. One being the general market sentiment has been pretty negative since, you know, we debuted December 16th of last year. So the majority of the time has been the early part of this year, which has been tough sort of globally. Sentiment around SPACs and DSPACs has been more negative than that. And, you know, the future for us, in my view, is very simple. The only thing that we can do to impact price, excuse me, is to continue to operate the business and to put up strong results. And, you know, to the extent that we're able to put up results in line with what we've done historically and what our expectations have been, then very quickly or fairly quickly, I would think that the market will disconnect us from the rest of the DSPAC crowd and realize that this is just a high quality business that ought to be public. It belongs where it is, and that it's extremely valuable. And, you know, I think you'll see the market figure that out sooner rather than later.
Thank you for joining us for this C-Suite interview presentation brought to you by Channel Check. View our YouTube channel for more video content, including C-Suite interviews, virtual roadshows, and conference presentation replays. New content is added regularly, so subscribe below to stay up to date. Visit channelcheck.com or click the link in the description to access equity research, news, and advanced market data on this and the 6,000 other small and micro cap companies listed.